Jai Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Jai Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Gopi Jana Vallabha Girivara Dhari. Yashodanandana Braja Janaranjana. Yamuna Tira Vanachari. Yamuna Tira Vanachari. Jayo Radha Madhava Jayo Kunja Bihari. Jayo Gopi Jana Vallabha Jayo Girivara Dhari. Jayo Girivara Dhari. Jayo Gopi Jana Vallabha. Yashoda Nandana Raja Janaranjana. Yashoda Nandana Yamuna Tira Vanachari. Jayo Radha Madhava Jayam Vishnupada Paramhamsa Parivrajakacharya Shtotra Shusha Shrimad His Divine Grace of Charanaravind Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Jayam Vishnupada Paramhamsa Parivrajakacharya Shtotra Shusha Shrimad Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Goswami Prabhupada Ji Maharaj Ki Jai. Anant Koti Vaishnavrind Ki Jai. Namacharya Srila Hridas Thakur Ki Jai. Prem Se Kaho Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shadveda Gadadhar Shivasadi Gaur Bhaktivrind Ki Jai. Shad Goswami Prabhugan Ki Jai. Grantharash Shrimad Bhagavat Mahapurana Ki Jai. Harinam Sankirtan Ki Jai. Nitai Igor Premanande. All glories to assembled devotees. All glories to assembled devotees. All glories to assembled devotees. All glories, all glories, all glories to Sri Guru and Sri Gauranga. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Narayanam namaskrityam naram chaiva narottamam devim saraswatim vyasam tato jayamudirayet nashtaprayeshva bhadreshu nityam bhagavata sevaya bhagavati uttama shloke bhaktir bhavati naishtiki krishnaya vasudevaya devaki nandanaya cha nanda gopakumaraya govindaya namo namaha Om Ajnana Timirandhasya Jnanan Janashalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Mano Bhishtam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamahiyam Dadati Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yuta Padakamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamsha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunathanvitam Tvam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadhutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padan Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakhanvitamscha Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prishthaya Bhutale Shrimate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Nitinamine Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Shatideshatarine Namo Mahavadanyaya Krishna Prema Pradayate Krishnaya Krishna Chaitanya Namne Gaurat Vishay Namaha He Krishna Karuna Sindho Dinabandho Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vanshakalpatarurbhyascha Kripa Sindhu Bhyaye Vacha Patitanam Pavane Bhyo Vaishnave Bhyo Namo Namaha Jai Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Srivasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Rama Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Sarva Shastra Abdi Piyusha, Sarva Vedaika Satfala, Sarva Siddhanta Ratnadhya, Sarva Lokaika Drikprada, Sarva Bhagavata Prana, Srimad Bhagavatam Prabho, Kalidhvanto Ditaditya, Shri Krishna Parivartita. Shri Raja Uvacha Yani Yani Hakarmani Yaryai Swachanda Janmabhi Chakre Karoti Kartava Haristani Bruvantunah Shri Raja Uvacha Yani Yani Hakarmani Yaryai Swachanda Janmabhi Chakre Karoti Kartava Haristani Bruvantunah Shri Raja Uvacha Yani Yani Hakarmani Yaryai Swachanda Janmabhi Chakre Karoti Kartava Haristani Bruvantuna Haristani Bruvantuna Shri Raja Uvacha Yani Yani Hakarmani Yaryai Swachanda Janmabhi Chakre Karoti Kartava Bruvantunaha Shri Raja Uvacha Yani yani ha karmani. Matajis. Chanta Chanmabhi Chakre Karoti Kartava Vistani Bravantuna Shri Raja Vacha. The king said, Yani Yani, each Iha in this world, Karmani of the activities. Yai yai, by each. Swachanda, assumed independently. Janma bihi, of the appearances. Chakre, he performed. Karoti, is performing. Karta, will perform. Va, or. Harihi, the Supreme Lord Hari. Tani, these. Bruvantu, please tell. Naha, us. Translation and purport by the disciples of His Divine Grace, S. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. King Nimi said, the Supreme Personality of Godhead descends into the material world by His internal potency and according to His own desire. Therefore, please tell us about the various pastimes Lord Hari has performed in the past, is performing now, and will perform in this world in the future in his various incarnations. Purport. In this fourth chapter, the son of Jayanti, Drumila, will address King Nimi. The 48th verse of the third chapter is stated, Murtaya Abhimatyatmanaha. One should worship the particular form of the Lord most attractive to oneself. Similarly, it was stated in the previous chapter, Stavai Stutva Named Harim. One should bow down to Lord Hari after glorifying him with prayers. Thus, it is assumed that the worshipper has knowledge of the Supreme Lord's transcendental qualities and pastimes in order to execute the process of worship previously described. King Nimi, therefore, is eagerly inquiring about the various incarnations of the Supreme Lord so that he can ascertain which particular form of the Supreme Lord is most suitable for his personal worship. It is understood that King Nimi is a Vaishnava, or devotee, who is trying to advance in the transcendental loving service of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. It is important to note in this regard that the word Abhimat Murti, meaning one's most desirable form, does not indicate that one may concoct a form of the Lord by one's own whim. Advaitam achyutam anadim anantarupam. All the forms of the Supreme Lord are anadim, or eternal. Thus, there is no question of concocting a form, because such a concoction would be adi, or the origin of the concocted form. Abhimat Murti means that among the eternal forms of the Lord, one should select that form which most inspires one's love for the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Such love cannot be imitated, but it is automatically aroused when one follows the prescribed rules and regulations given by the bona fide spiritual master and submissively hears these descriptions of Srimad Bhagavatam. Hare Krishna. Translation once again. King Nimi said, the Supreme Personality of Godhead descends into the material world by His internal potency and according to His own desire. Therefore, please tell us about the various pastimes Lord Hari has performed in the past, is performing now, and will perform in this world in the future in His various incarnations. So, grateful to be here with all the devotees, sharing, trying, making an attempt to share something on this particular verse of Srimad Bhagavatam, the 11th canto. So this is the seventh question King Nimi is asking in a sequence of questions to the Navayogendras. Chamas and Karbhajan are about to come, the next two, where the famous verses about the appearance of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu will also come into picture. Actually, these are very exalted personalities, and generally to inquire about the Supreme Personality of God and about spiritual subject matter requires a humble state of mind. Imagine being the king of the, not just some state in India or this country of India, but that of the entire Jambudvipa or a significant portion of the Varsha, and asking very submissively these questions. So King Nimi, he was son of Maharaj Ikshvaku. Maharaj Ikshvaku had a very strange kind of birth. He was born of the sneezing of Lord Brahma, Vaivaswat Manu. Because Vaivaswat Manu was having difficulty, he didn't have a son. So finally Vashishtha did a yajna, but the wife wanted a daughter. So the priest, they chanted a separate mantra and the daughter was born. His name was Ila, her name was Ila. And then Vaivaswat Manu said, what's going on here? What happened to your promise? Vashishtha said. He asked Vashishtha. Then Vashishtha transformed back to a male, becomes Sudyumna. And then we know he entered somehow Ilavrat Varsha, and then again he became a woman. And then 1 month man, 1 month woman. Pretty intense life for Sudyumna, the first son. And finally he kind of got, little detached from the whole thing, and he went to the forest. After that, Vaivaswat Manu is thinking, I need a son. So Bhagavatam says 10 sons were born, of which Ikshvaku was the main, but Ikshvaku was not born through Shraddha, his wife, but he was born through the sneezing of Vaivaswat Manu, very special personality. So he had 100 sons, and three of their names is mentioned in the Bhagavatam, of which Nimi is one of the prominent ones. And then there are other people also. So King Nimi is no ordinary personality, actually. It is his lineage in which later on Mother Sita will appear. So Maharaj Nimi once upon a time wanted to perform an elaborate yajna. So he called Vashishtha Muni, can you please come? Vashishtha, son of Lord Brahma. So Vashishtha said, I'm busy. I'm already booked with Indra Yajna. So we have to wait. So he said, he was so eager to perform the yajna because the yajna also involved glorification of Krishna. So he said, okay, you can't come, we'll get somebody else. So he got somebody else perform the yajna, and Vashishtha came to know. And he was not very happy. So he became very angry and he cursed Maharaj Nimi, may you die. So this will happen after this pastime, not before this. So, and then Nimi also became quite angry. He said, why are you becoming so mad at me? I just got somebody else to perform a yajna. Be cool. Next yajna you can do. And then he counter-cursed Vashishtha that may you also die. And both of them died. So Vashishtha was later on born as son of Mitra and Varuna, who, when they kind of became agitated upon seeing Guru Vashi. And Nimi Maharaj's body was kept by the sages in fragrant chemicals, Bhagavatam says. Fragrant chemicals it was kept. And it was kept fresh, and then all the priests, they performed the yajna, and the demigods appeared. And when the demigods appeared, they were very pleased, and the sages just requested one thing. Can you please bring Nimi back to life? And the demigods said, fine, that's not a big problem. So he said, Nimi, please come back to life. And Nimi said, I don't want. I don't want to come back to life. Anyways, what is the use of this material body? Obnoxious. Now, here is a personality who is not suffering from some job issues or family issues or this issue or that issue, or in his estate the brahmanas were not behaving properly or the sannyasis were kind of deviating. It was not like that. But still he thought, material body is obnoxious, let's drop it. And the demigods were so pleased upon seeing Nimi's determination, they said, okay Nimi, if that is your desire, you want in the spiritual body, by the dint of your devotional service, let you be in your spiritual body. But then the sages needed a king who would rule. So then the sages had a standard system of churning the bodies. So Veena's body was churned, Prithu was born, Archie was born. So here Maharaj Nimi's body was churned, and then Janaka was born. Now this Janaka is not father of Mother Sita.
Janak is a title which kind of passes on in this particular lineage. Janaka actually means one who is born, Ja, in another way, Anya. So he is Janaka. And therefore he sometimes also called as Vaideha, because Nimi Maharaj had already given up his body, Videha, he had already given up the body, and from that Janaka was born. In fact, when Nimi Maharaj was introduced in the 11th canto of Bhagavatam, this term was used for him, Videha. Because sometimes he is also called somebody who didn't have a body. I mean, he's famous with that name. And that's from that pastime comes the name Mithila, and because from the manthan of the body of Maharaj Nimi, Janaka was born. So, and this personality, Drumila, whom we are talking about, he is now here introduced as son of Jayanti. Now, Jayanti is the wife of Rishabhdev, who was given by Lord Indra to him. And Jayanti was the mother of these exalted 100 sons headed by Bharat Maharaj, and then these 9 renunciants, and then I think 19 of them became Kshatriyas and 81 of them became Yagyik Brahmanas, like that. So all these exalted sages were present. So we could see King Nimi's eagerness to hear Harikatha. We see that same eagerness in Parikshit Maharaj permeating through Bhagavatam. We see that eagerness in Vidura asking Maitreya. All these people are very eager, because eagerness is like the digestive fire which digests the sweet nectarian Harikatha. Otherwise, you know, it just passes over. So, and in the case of these sages, we see all of them, 9 of them are answering one after the other. And I was just seeing, once when the one answer is over, it is not that other sages came and pitched in. Hey, you kind of forgot this part, or I have a better thing of. They were all submissively hearing what one of their brothers was talking about. And I remember last year, His Holiness Radhana Swami Maharaj was giving a class, and where he was making this point of the 4 Kumaras having a discussion, and how they chose one amongst them as the, you know, as the person who is going to answer, and everybody else submissively heard. And he was making this point that, you know, if we just take, you know, pleasure in hearing and chanting amongst our equals, amongst our juniors, amongst our seniors, you know, there is no problem as such. So here in this verse, he says, Yaye Swachanda Janmabhi. So in Bhagavatam, it's not just, we'll talk about it as we move forward, but it is a very deep theological treatise of the Gaudiya Vaishnavas. It's not just a compilation of the histories of the kings and things like that. It's a highly evolved presentation of theology that has ever happened in this cosmic manifestation. So when various, of course, it may not appear chronological, because Bhagavatam moves more with rasa. So as the rasas move, then the philosophy also gets unveiled through the prayers of great exalted people. So tattva is revealed through that. So we see here, time and again, it will be expressed by various devotees about the ontological position of Krishna. So, yai yai swachanda janmabhi, in the 9th canto of Bhagavatam, when the pot of eagerness of Parikshit Maharaj is boiling over, 4 days is already over. It's the end of 4th day when the 9th canto's last chapter is being spoken. And the 5th day morning is where the 10th canto of Bhagavatam begins. Jeev Goswami and other acharyas comment like that. So Parikshit Maharaj is getting very eager, and he wants to now hear about Krishna. So Shukadeva Goswami begins to explain, because he already explained the entire Surya Vamsha. He explained Swayambhu Manu's 5 progenies, lineage. Then he came to Chandra Vamsha, and now Chandra Vamsha, almost 60 generations later, after Brahma, Krishna appears. So that's pretty far off. So he had to hear all that stuff. So finally, you know, he's on this brink of hearing about Krishna. So Shukdev Goswami is saying, Ashtamastu tayo rasi swayameva harikila subhadraja mahabhaga tavarajan pitamahi. Oh my dear Parikshit Maharaj, the 8th pregnancy of Devaki, Ashtamastu. So the word tu is indicated to contradict something which has already been spoken. So he's saying, this 8th progeny which has come about, it is Swayam Hari. It is Supreme Personality of Godhead himself. And he is very intimately connected to your family because his sister Subhadra was your grandmother. Tavrajan Pitamahi. So he explains, he gives a general description of why does the Lord appears. And we all know that verse. Something similar appears. Yada yadahi dharmasya kshayo vriddhischa papmanaha tadatu bhagavanisha atmanam srajate hari. So this is a general reason for Krishna's appearance. Because if it is, the acharyas kind of have a rebuttal. They say that if Krishna has to appear because the sins increase and therefore he has to appear, then Krishna's appearance is a material cause, which cannot be true. He cannot have a material reason for his appearance. But this is also a general reason for the Lord's appearance. And then Shukdev Goswami gives the actual reason. He's saying, Nahi yasya janmano hetu. There's no hetu for Krishna's janma. There's no reason for Krishna's appearance. Karmano va mahipate, or his activities. Oh mahipate, oh the emperor of earth, Krishna has no reason. You may have reason to rule. You may have reason to occupy a post. Krishna has no reason, no binding upon him. So why does he do so many things? 90 chapters of the Bhagavatam, just describing activities of Krishna. So he's saying, Atma mayam vinesh vina ishasya parasya drashtur atmanaha. So he's saying, Atma mayam, Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur says, maya means deceit in general, but maya also means mercy, kripa. So the only reason why Krishna appears, Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur is commenting, is that Atma mayam, because of his compassion for the jiva. In fact, whatever the Lord does in relation to the jiva and the world is just for one impetus, compassion. He's just, you know, he's katar means he's habituated to show compassion, right? So once Gaur Gopal Prabhu explained this word katara, he's habituated to give mercy, even if he says no, but ultimately say okay, take it, because he can't just resist himself from giving kripa. He's kind. But then somebody asks, how does he comes to know about the situation of the jiva? He's situated in Golok Vrindavan, dancing in the courtyard of Nanda Maharaj. How does he come to know about our suffering? So he's saying here, very beautifully, Drashtur Atmana, he's seated as a super soul in the heart of the jiva. Therefore, he comes to know very intimately. You don't have to go and explain him. He knows that you're suffering, you're struggling. What all he expects from us is a humble sense of surrender towards him. The rest will be taken care. He already knows. So, and the effect of that mercy is that he appears and acts in this material world. And Shukdev Goswami corroborates this particular theological point by stating, using a kaimuttika nyaya, he says, Are what to speak of intimate pastimes in Vrindavan, his pastimes in relation to this material world, even the manifestation of this material world, which is done by his expansion of an expansion of an expansion, is because of his love and compassion for the jiva. Yan maya cheshtitam pumsaha sthiti utpatti apyayaya hi anugrahas tananirvrittair atmalabhaya cha ishyate. Why does Krishna appear? Ishyate, because of anugraha. And that anugraha's purpose is tananirvritte. He wants the jiva to escape the cycle of birth and death and attain what? Atmalabhaya. The real good fortune of the jiva, which is residence in the spiritual world. So sometimes people ask, Are in the material world, there is in the creation, there is so much suffering. How is that compassion? So the Lord's plan is that, okay, the jiva has many desires. Let him try to enjoy. And no matter who you are, if you try to enjoy matter, you will get implicated. You will suffer. And then ultimately you get detached. And one fine day you might think about the actual questions of why am I suffering? And what is the purpose of life? So this comes in the 10th canto also, when the prayers of personified Vedas were being sung. They say this. Why does Krishna creates, the Lord creates buddhi, indriya, mana, prana, jananam, srajate, prabhu? He creates all these very, very complex system of body, mind, intelligence, just so that the jiva can try to enjoy. Matrartham. Matrartham means he can enjoy matter, he can enjoy the senses. cha bhavartham, thereby he will get repeated cycle of birth and death. Cha atmane akalpanaya cha, and ultimately, one day he will think, let me get out. This cycle is too much of a turmoil. And Krishna has such unlimited patience, he waits till then. And pure devotees come into picture and they expedite the process. Otherwise, for the jiva on his own, it's not possible. Illusion is too powerful. So in this way, Shukdev Goswami, after explaining Parikshit Maharaj, how Krishna is so kind by performing his pastimes, he's delivering not only his devotees, but even people who are unfavorable to him. Tathaiva chanye naraloka veera ya ahave Krishna mukharavindam netre pibanto nayanabhiramam parthastra puta padama purasya. Third canto Bhagavatam, Uddhav, again, melting point of his eagerness to remember Krishna, and this is what he's remembering. How Krishna is so kind. He delivered even these soldiers who were inimical to him just by giving his darshan. Of course, they were purified by Arjuna's arrows. Parthastra puta padama purasya. They attained the ultimate destination. So then the question is, as if Krishna is all merciful, then what to speak of those living entities who were not so fortunate to be in his presence when he was physically manifesting those pastimes? Shukdev Goswami comes to rescue and he's saying, Kalau janishyamana nam dukkha shoka tamonudam. This is a special brand of people in Kali Yuga. Kalau janishyamana nam. These people who are born in Kali Yuga, to minimize their unhappiness and lamentation, anugrahaya bhaktanam. Again, anugraha. Why does Krishna create, he performs so many pastimes? Just so that the jiva in future will have something positive to absorb his consciousness in and be attracted to the realm of Golok Vrindavan. He doesn't have to. Those pastimes are eternally going on in the spiritual world. But anugrahaya bhaktanam supunyam. Just by hearing, your piety increases. Supunyam. Vyatanod yashaha. And his glories are ever expanding. That means you will never be able to get satiated just by hearing about him. Even though you go on hearing the same pastime again and again, Vyatanod yashaha. His glories are ever expanding. And Shukadeva Goswami says that effect of that hearing is same as if you are in personal presence of the Lord. Of course, there is a quality to that hearing, he classifies. He's saying, Yasmin Satkarna Piyushe, when this Harikatha is received through the purified ears, Satkarna, not Asatkarna, not the Karna which is accustomed to hearing Prajalpa, Satkarna Piyushe. Just like in Ayurveda, when they do treatment, first they do cleansing of the body, so that the medicine starts working. So similarly, several years, decades, and sometimes lifetimes are spent just becoming qualified to hear Harikatha. So it says, Satkarna Piyushe Yashastirtha Vaire Sakrat Shrotanjali Upasprishya. He creates an ear like a cupped hands to receive this elixir of Harikatha. And when as soon as, what is the sign somebody is receiving Harikatha through Satkarna? He's receiving it Satkarna through a Shrotanjali. He's saying, Dhunote Karma Vasanam. His desire for fruitive activities will be completely removed from the heart. That is the sign somebody is hearing in the proper frame of mind and the heart. So therefore, that was precise reason why Shukdev Goswami is speaking Harikatha to Parikshit Maharaj. And we have Srimad Bhagavatam as a consequence of that conversation. Now, post 1966, Srimad Bhagavatam has been made very easily accessible. And sometimes when things are easily accessible, we might lose value of it. In fact, one of the scholars, I think I mentioned it earlier also, when he went to 22nd Avenue for the first time, the one thing that impressed him the most was as soon as he walked in, on the table he saw the translation of the first canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. And he was surprised. He was not impressed by the followers, by the devotees at that time, but he saw that this Swami has a translation of, because he was doing PhD in the Bhagavatam. And at that time, the only English edition of Bhagavatam was available only in two libraries in the world. One was Harvard, and the other was probably Yale University. That's all. Otherwise, you need to know Sanskrit, decode the commentaries. And I remember, you know, once Gaurang Prabhu and Gaurgopal Prabhu, all of us were there, and they showed us those big commentaries, which is there in GEV, right? All those 10 Acharyas commentaries, and just to figure them out and come to a crisp understanding of what it is, how many of us would have that enthusiasm? So it's a very rare fortune to actually receive Srimad Bhagavatam. It is said in Padma Puran that even demigods don't get to hear it. It's very rare to get an opportunity to hear Srimad Bhagavatam. So once Radhika Valla Prabhu was explaining us how there are four meanings of Srimad Bhagavatam. Personality who's relishing Bhagavatam every now and then, so we keep getting some nectar jewels here and there. So he was quoting Bhagavat Sandarbha. He said there are four meanings of Srimad Bhagavatam. And he said, Bhagavat Proktamiti, it was spoken by Bhagavan. Bhagavat Pratipadakam Iti, its subject is Bhagavan. Bhagavad Akarshakam Iti, Bhagavan gets attracted to one who hears or even desires to hear Srimad Bhagavatam. Bhagavad Akarshakam Iti. And the fourth meaning Prabhuji was explaining was Bhagavat Prema Prayojakam. Its purpose is to bestow love for Bhagavan, ultimately. Prema Phal Pradayakam, Padma Puran says. That is the purpose of Srimad Bhagavatam. So Srimad Bhagavatam, you know, it's quite a phenomenal thing if you look from a literary point of view, because Bhagavatam talks of at least 3,000 celestials and kings in its pages. And 30 different incarnations and more of Vishnu. And while describing all of that, under the emergency of the death of the emperor of the planet, Shukdev Goswami makes sure that the focus doesn't divert even an inch from the supreme entity Krishna. And that was only possible because he himself was relishing. So, the Srimad Bhagavatam is, Gopi Pranandan Prabhu writes in Tattva Sandarbha, how it's not just a compilation of life histories of various kings, but it's a very deep theological exposition. However, it is presented in a very sanguine manner of prayers offered by the various devotees of Krishna, and that's how theology is presented. However, before Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu appeared on this planet, there were people talking about Bhagavatam, there were commentaries on the Bhagavatam like Vijayadvaj Tirtha and Veera Raghava Acharya from Ramanujan Madhvas, but mostly people would focus on Vedanta Sutra. Then Lord Chaitanya, as an incarnation of grace and mercy, he re-emphasized the significance of this book, primarily by instructing the six Goswamis to write literatures based on those Shastras. And he extensively spoke Srimad Bhagavatam in the medium of instructions to Rupa Goswami, Sanatana Goswami. And also, he personally heard Srimad Bhagavatam regularly in Jagannath Puri on the banks of Narendra Sarovar by Gadadhar Pandit. So there were various commentaries, although Lord Chaitanya did not really emphasize on writing a commentary on Srimad Bhagavatam, but nevertheless, just to expound its deep philosophical meaning and compositions, various devotees did wrote various commentaries, like the oldest is Sridhar Swami, which is 700 years old, which existed even at the time of Sri Chaitanya Deva. And then is that Chaitanya Mat Manjusha, who was written by Srinath Chakravarti, where you find that famous verse, Aradhya Bhagavan Rajesh Tanaya Taddhama Vrindavanam. This verse comes in Chaitanya Mat Manjusha. Then Srila Sanatana Goswami wrote Vaishnav Toshni, Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur wrote very elaborately called Sarar Darshani. And then Jiv Goswami, the most prolific work on Bhagavatam came in the form of the Shad Sandarbhas, which was actually started by Gopal Bhatt Goswami, but then given shape, presented very methodically by Jiva Goswami. And then Jiva Goswami wrote seventh Sandarbha, or they call sometimes, it is called Krama Sandarbha, but that is his commentary on the Srimad Bhagavatam. And Gopi Paranadhan Prabhu says that Srila Prabhupada referred to Krama Sandarbha very extensively while giving his own purports, apart from Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur. Therefore, Jiv Goswami even goes on to say that it is the Pratinidhi Roop of Sri Krishna. It's not, he even doesn't consider it just a Shruti. He considers it that to be the most exalted form of, you know, Shruti. It doesn't even consider it Smriti. So Srimad Bhagavatam deals with two kind of devotees. And why am I speaking this is because the last line of the purport said that by submissively hearing the descriptions of Srimad Bhagavatam, one can arouse one's love for Krishna. So how does that happen? So there are two kind of audiences of the Bhagavatam, or two levels, I would say, not kinds, two levels. First is those who are already steeped in devotion, they have naturally attracted to Krishna. Nigamakalpataror galitam phalam shukamukhadamrita dravya samyutam pibata bhagavatam rasamalayam muhar aho rasika bhavu bhavuka. These are the rasiks who are relishing the mellows of Bhagavatam. People like Shukadev Goswami, Sri Chaitanya Dev, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and all these Kadadar Pandit, they're relishing Srimad Bhagavatam. And second are those who are somewhere along the path to such devotional perfection. Not yet perfect, moving forward. And how does Bhagavatam does that? By gradually attracting them to Sri Krishna and his devotional service. Because learning to love Krishna requires three things. Tattva Sandarbha explains that. Learning to love Krishna requires three things. He says, first is, one need to undergo a preliminary study of the nature, qualities and activities of Krishna. Second, one need to understand what kind of relationships Krishna wants from us and what kind of relationships Krishna maintains with his devotees. And then the third thing is, what obstructs and prevents us from striking that relationship. So Srimad Bhagavatam, through various, you know, ways and means, it tries to impart those strong lessons so that the conditionings break and we revive our relationship with Krishna. So like, there is a book called Mukta Phala by an author, by a scholar called Himadri, where our devotees in Govardhaniko village, when they made their first Ratnamala book, behind that they mentioned this verse. The source is this Mukta Phala book. Vedam Puranam Kavyam Cha Prabhum Mitram Priyeva Cha Bodhayanti Itihi Prahu Trivrit Bhagavatam Puna. It is said, generally Vedas instruct like a master, Puranas instruct like a friend, and Kavya instruct like a beloved. Very intimate. He says, but Bhagavatam instructs in all three ways. It instructs like a master, right? There are so many direct instructions by Krishna's various incarnation, like Vamandev is speaking or Kapila is speaking, direct instructions, hard hitting. That's like Veda. Then Bhagavatam also instructs like a Puran, like a Mitra, by some friendly discussions. Narad Muni talking to Prachina Parishad. And there are so many stories being played around and very friendly, in the mood of suggestion, not really hitting them hard. And then as a beloved, in the form of the various intimate prayers, the same Bhagavatam has prayers offered by Srimati Radharani, the gopis of Vrindavan, which is extremely intimate. So in this way, Bhagavatam is very special. And therefore, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, while he is describing, he is instructing Sanatana Goswami for a period of 2 months in Banaras, and he concludes his teachings in Chaitanya Charitamrita by stating this verse, when that Atmaram verse is explained. He says, Aham vedmi shuko vetti vyaso vetti na vetti va bhaktya bhagavatam grahayam na buddhya na chatikaya. This Bhagavatam cannot be understood by intelligence, neither by extensive speculation or imaginary commentaries. And Lord Shiva is speaking this verse. I may know, Shukdev may know, but Vyasdev may or may not know Srimad Bhagavatam. So why are we sitting here? What is our hope if Vyasdev doesn't know? So then, how is it that, why is Lord Shiva stating this? That only Shukdev can know, not Vyas can know. Because Shukdev Goswami first time heard Bhagavatam from Lord Shiva. So once upon a time, Lord Shiva, this exalted couple, exemplary personalities, Lord Shiva and Mother Parvati sitting in Kailash, and Lord Shiva is in his meditation, and Mother Parvati one day suddenly asks a question that, my dear Lord, why do you wear these skulls in your neck? And whose skulls are these? That is an interesting question. Ye khopdi hai kiski? So Lord Shiva smiles at her and says, these are your heads. Parvati says, what do you mean? He said, these are the various lives you have taken, various births you have taken, and you become my consort, and whenever you died, I kept your skull. As a memento, you know, just remembrance of the wife. So Parvati became quizzical. He said, which means I keep dying and you don't? Something I don't have which you have creates some uneasiness. So he said, yeah, I don't die. He said, why you don't die? Why are you immortal? He said, because I'm absorbed in Srimad Bhagavatam. He said, bataya nahi kabhi aapne? Never told me that you are always absorbed in Srimad Bhagavatam. You kept secrets from your wife. He doesn't say that. But so she's very eagerly presenting, Lord, please tell me also this Srimad Bhagavatam. He said, all right, condition. In that class, nobody should come. Only you. And generally when I speak Bhagavatam, I go into Samadhi. So I will not know whether you are sleeping or awake. So you may keep making this sound. Okay? I agreed. So they went to Ekamravan in Bhubaneswar. Lord Shiva's place. And he sat down there and started glorifying Bhagavatam. And as usual, Bhagavatam, Lord Shiva is Vaishnavanam, Yathashambhu. He went into Samadhi. And Mother Parvati is listening and is doing And Lord Shiva continued explaining, and then suddenly he opened his eyes in between and saw Parvati was sleeping. Nothing new, isn't it? So Parvati was sleeping when Bhagavatam discussion was going on, and Lord Shankar was hearing this sound of And then he saw, where is the sound coming from? And he saw a parrot sitting, Ashoka. And he's making that sound, while hearing Bhagavatam. So Lord Shankar became very angry. Two reasons. First condition violated. Nobody should have been here. Second, Parvati is sleeping. Imagine you just have one audience, and that too, upon invitation you are speaking, and he also sleeps. You need to be really in love with Krishna to be able to do that, to continue speaking. So Lord Shankar started chasing that Shuka. And the Shuka went flying from Bhubaneswar to Badrikashram. Quite a flight. And in Badrikashram, Vyasadeva was sitting speaking Bhagavatam. To whom? To his wife. And she was fortunately not sleeping. Rather, she was in amazement. Her mouth was wide open. So as her mouth was wide open and she was listening, Shuka came and entered her mouth. And Lord Shankar came behind. Vyas, where is that Shuka? He said, my dear Lord, why are you so angry? Pacify. Peaceful. He said, this person has violated the condition. I was reciting Bhagavatam to my wife, and it was supposed to be a very private conversation, and he kind of interfered. I'll kill him. Vyasadeva smiled. He said, my dear Lord, please understand, because he has heard Bhagavatam from you, he has become immortal. Therefore, you can't kill him now. So let him be in the womb of my wife. And then we know Shukadeva Goswami appears. So therefore, Lord Shiva makes this statement that Shuka Veti, Vyasa Veti, Naveti. I don't know whether Vyasa understands. Of course, we should not doubt whether Vyasa really knows or have some, give up Bhagavatam. No, this is a way of glorifying Shukadeva Goswami also. So Bhagavatam, it has this special feature, because many of these Puranas also deal with many of these stories which are there in the Bhagavatam. But Bhagavatam has several surprising role reversals in its presentation that are essential to the text grand narrative. And why Shukadeva Goswami does that? To emphasize the sole message of Bhagavatam, that bhakti is supreme. Therefore, there are various role reversals you will see. And he wants to show that bhakti, loving devotion to Krishna, it trumps any kind of dominance in this world. Therefore, you will see in Srimad Bhagavatam, demons who are better than gods, Vritrasura, wives who are smarter than husbands. Nowadays, they are also there, but wives who are smarter than husbands, like the Brahmin Patnis in Vrindavan, they decided to surrender to Krishna. Or kings who are more powerful than even great Brahmanas like Durvasa and Ambarish. And all these role reversals. So much so that in Rigveda, Vritrasura's pastime is explained, and Vritrasura is presented a demon. and Indra is the hero. But when it came to Bhagavatam, it was reversed. Vritra is the main hero, and Indra is like a student trying to learn these deep lessons from Vritrasura about bhakti. So, Skanda Purana explains then what is Srimad Bhagavatam basically, because we hear sometimes there are four verses spoken by Lord Brahma, and then there are, we have 18,000 and the one that we have is 14,000. What's going on here? What exactly is Bhagavatam? So he says, Sri Krishna Asakta Bhaktanam Tan Madhurya Prakashakam Sammujram Bhatiyad Vakyam Vidhi Bhagavatam Hitat. Vidhi Bhagavatam Hitat, oh my dear, you know, please understand that this is Uddhava's conversation in ISKCON Puran. Vidhi Bhagavatam Hitat is anything that comes from the mouth of those devotees who are deeply attracted to Krishna. Shri Krishna Asakta Bhaktanam, those who are hearts are attached to Krishna, when they speak certain sweet words, that is Srimad Bhagavatam. So Uddhavji is explaining that Bharate Manavam Janma Prapya Bhagavatam Nayaihi Shrutam Pap Pradhinayir Atma Ghata Astu Taikrita. If somebody is born in the land of Bharatvarsha and does not study or hear Srimad Bhagavatam, he is committing suicide. It's a very, you know, unfortunate situation. And what is the significance, benefit to attract people? Since Pitra Paksha is also going on. Srimad Bhagavatam Shastram Nityam Yai Parisevitam Pitur Matuscha Bharyayah Kulapankti Sutarita. If someone hears, regularly hears or recites Srimad Bhagavatam, he delivers the forefathers of his wife, mother and father. Everyone is delivered just by hearing and reciting Srimad Bhagavatam. And he goes on to explain various benefits that come by hearing, you know, Srimad Bhagavatam. So, we have brief time. So, he explains and what is the proper mood of hearing Bhagavatam. And I had heard a couple of years back from Shikshashtakam Prabhu, these four favorable and unfavorable modes of hearing Srimad Bhagavatam. Pravara chatako hamsa shuko meenadayastatha avara vrik bhurunda vrisho ustradaya prakirtitaha. The four kind of favorable listeners are, he says, chataka bird, swan, parrot and fish. He says, like a chataka bird, he takes only water that comes from rain cloud. Similarly, a chataka like audience or listener, he takes only the pure message of Bhagavatam, nothing else. Then a swan, from a mixture of milk and water, he can extract milk. So if a lot of things are being discussed, a swan-like audience can just pick up the message of the Bhagavatam and rest aside, he just leaves. Doesn't even comment on them, just leaves aside. Parrot, just like a parrot can, you know, verbatim repeat what he has heard, that kind of audience can verbatim repeat what he has heard. And fish is like, just like a fish is swimming with the eyes wide open in the condensed milk ocean. Similarly, this kind of listener, he gazes at the speaker with unblinking eyes and drinks the nectar of Harikatha. And whenever I see Gopinath Chandra Prabhu, Shadbuj Prabhu sitting in front of Maharaj with unblinking eyes, he's like, Meenadaya, that kind of. Of course, there could be Chatak also and all the other things. But and the inferior listeners, he says, like a wolf, like a Bhurund the bird, like a bull and like a camel. Just like a wolf in a peaceful night will suddenly start making irritable sounds. Similarly, in a melodious Harikatha going on, a wolf kind of listener will start shouting in between, just like that. Like it used to happen in Prabhupada's time. He would be speaking and suddenly one gentleman got up, hippie, said, I am God! Prabhupada said, please accept my humble obeisance, sit down. Let us continue to hear. So there are people kind of interfere. Then the Bhurunda bird, so this Bhurunda bird has, Shukdev, in this, we don't know what is Bhurunda bird. I googled it, Google failed. Bhurunda, I didn't know what Bhurunda is. So Bhurunda bird has this capacity. He goes on instructing everybody in the forest about what he has heard, and he himself doesn't practice. Bhurunda. So then a bull will eat oil cakes and sweet grapes, everything. So ye log sabko sun lete hain. Right, such kind of listeners hears everything. They will hear Bhagavatam also, then they'll hear some other category of prajalpa also, we all know. And they're happy, they're okay with all that. And a camel, he says, he gives up mango leaves and chews upon thorns and relishes blood. So such a person gives up nectar of Harikatha and he hears some blasphemy, some criticism or some fault finding on some mundane stuff. So we all can gauge ourselves where we are on the scale. Depends also, different frames of mind. So Bhagavatam, it has different narrations of Srimad Bhagavatam has appeared. The first was when Lord Narayan spoke to Brahma. He spoke to Vishnu also. And he spoke to Lord Shiva also to help them in their roles of creation, maintenance and destruction. And it is explained, after hearing from Lord Narayan, Vishnu spoke Bhagavatam and that continued. When Lord Brahma speaks Bhagavatam, that continues for 7 days in Brahmaloka. When Vishnu speaks, it continues for 1 month. And when Lakshmiji repeats back, it exists for 2 months. So Acharya has explained, why is that so? He said, because Lakshmi doesn't have anxieties of maintenance. So Vishnu has anxiety, so he kind of finishes it off faster and Lakshmi goes into more details of 2 months. And Lord Rudra, you know, resides for, they say, 1 year. So first of all, the Bhagavatam actually manifested in the land of Vrindavan on the banks of Kusum Sarovar. Uddhavji recited this Srimad Bhagavatam to pacify the queens of Dwarka in their separation to Sri Krishna. And that the culmination of this narration was when all the Dwarka queens, they all went back to the spiritual realm when Krishna. So it is explained that Shukadeva Goswami, so this time when Uddhav is speaking this, Uddhavji is speaking this Bhagavatam to the queens of Dwarka, he tells Parikshit Maharaj, you go and subdue Kali. So that's what we see in the first canto. So he goes and subdues Kali, so he doesn't get to hear. So he's asking Uddhavji, I also want to hear. He said, no, you go perform this service and through you, Krishna very soon will manifest Bhagavatam in a way that the whole world will get benefited. So you go and subdue Kali. So that's the time when Uddhavji is narrating Bhagavatam. And later on, Shukadeva Goswami spoke to Parikshit Maharaj, which is started on the day after Radhashtami, on the Navami of the Bhadra, on the bright moon side. And that is approximately 30 years after Krishna's disappearance. Then there are several other narrations also, which is then Gokarna speaks to Dundukari. Now that's an interesting story, but we don't have time to go into that detail. Which is around 200 years later, Gokarna recites to Dundukari, and then this narration is quoted by the four Kumaras when they console Narad Muni. When Narad Muni was exasperated in his attempts to revive Bhakti Devi, four Kumaras tell him that you please recite Srimad Bhagavatam. And that happened again 30 years later after this. That happened in the month of Kartik actually, when four Kumaras recited Bhagavatam to Narad Muni. Incidentally, when Gokarna, just one thing I'd like to mention, Gokarna and Dundukari's pastime was happening and Gokarna is reciting Bhagavatam. Actually, Suryadev tells him, Gokarna is not able to revive or make Dundukari's sin disappear. So then Sun God tells him, you recite Bhagavatam. So when he started reciting Bhagavatam, after the end of 7 days, Dundukari went back to the spiritual world. And there were hundreds and thousands of other people who were also listening. And nothing happened to them. So Gokarna asked in front of everybody, to those Vishnu Dutas who had come, why others didn't go? You baad mein bolenge na, isko to bhej diya, hame chhod diya yahan pe. We were in the same class. And then Vishnu Dutas speak a very nice words. He says, Shravanam tu kritam bhavarnair tatha mananam kritam falabhedas tato jato bhajanadapi manada. My dear Gokarna, the kind of focus and deep contemplation Dundukari was giving to the message of Srimad Bhagavatam, that intensity was not there with the rest of the audience. Therefore, they did not get the same benefit as Gokarna. So this happened in the month of Ashad. So then, this is actually, I think, May, June. So then, he spoke Bhagavatam again in Savan, a couple of months later. And then all those people who had come also got delivered and Gokarna also goes back to Godhead. So Lord Vishnu, to conclude, he says, O Brahma, among all types of festivals, The festival of discussing Srimad Bhagavatam is the topmost. Those who participate in such festivals for my pleasure and hear Srimad Bhagavatam with devotion, and those who worship Srimad Bhagavatam with cloth, ornaments, flowers, lamp, and incense, certainly control me just as a chaste wife controls her good husband. And the conclusion of the Srimad Bhagavatam is, Nama Sankirtanam Yasya Sarva Papa Pranashanam. The purpose of getting absorbed in Srimad Bhagavatam ultimately is to relish Hari Kirtan, to be absorbed in the chanting of the holy names. Kaler Dosh Nidhe Rajan Asti Heko Mahagunat Kirtana Deva Krishna Simukta Sangam Prajam Vajet. So, if we want to also develop taste in Srimad Bhagavatam and go deeper, we have to make voluntary efforts. This gift is given to us without us doing anything. At least thinking about myself, Prabhupada gave us this gift. But for preserving it, we'll have to work hard. And we cannot also downplay the significance of Srimad Bhagavatam by using Srimad Bhagavatam for our fame or to show off our learning or to get some honor. That is a very disrespectful behavior to Srimad Bhagavatam. Just to conclude this last thing, just like we were discussing with some devotees, Srimad Bhagavatam should not be treated like somebody, sorry to use this analogy, somebody, going around with his beautiful fiancé or girlfriend around and getting some prestige of how beautiful my wife is. We hopefully should not approach Bhagavatam to become so learned a scholar so that we get fame and prestige, because that defeats the purpose. Bhagavatam will give us that, but then hold the actual fruit of prema faladayakam, that love of God will not appear in our hearts. Bhagavatam can be approached, or a positive frame could be like a child approaches a mother for nourishment, for protection, from care. He is not worried about how his mother is dressed. He is not worried about how his mother is respected. He just knows one thing. Here is where I get care, protection, and shelter. And if I need to survive, this is the one thing that I need to take shelter of. So when we hear, read, appreciate, go deeper in the Bhagavatam, then Bhagavatam is a personality, is Krishna himself. They will also reveal much deeper imports, attract our hearts, make our life auspicious, and give us attraction for Krishna. And hopefully one day, our mind will also be able to dance in the courtyard of Nanda Maharaj, where Krishna is performing his sweet pastimes, and get detached from these distractions of this material world. Thank you very much. Sorry for going over time. I sincerely seek blessings, and please forgive me if I spoke something beyond my realization. I pray to all my Guru Varga here and all my other friends and devotees that I can apply also what I'm trying to present here. Thank you very much. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Granthara Srimad Bhagavat Mahapurana ki jai. Tai Gaur Premanande.